Hotep family, welcome back to the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. S.B. Fuller is a name that all of us should know. He is probably one of the first black billionaires. I mean, he was worth $100 million back in the 30s and 40s. And he's an absolute legend in Chicago, my hometown. And we actually found, or should I say he found me, his grandson, Martin Casey Fuller, who is going to be talking about this legend in business. And we're talking about someone who John H. Johnson, Mary Kay, sat at the feet of this man. So those people are legends, but there had to be a legend of the legend. And this is what we're talking about today. Welcome, Martin Casey Fuller. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing great. Thank you, Philippe.
Fantastic. Now, tell me about, give me a little bit of history about S.B. Fuller and what were some of his accomplishments that we need to know that the black community, or I shouldn't say black because that's a racial construct, but the African-American community needs to know.
Well, he was a pioneer in black economic development. He started back in 1935 selling soap door to door. He actually was working for a black insurance company. And the Chicago Tribune had the listings of all the different people and what they made. And he found out that the president of Lever Brothers made $485,000 a year. So he decided to stop selling insurance and start selling soap. So that started his career in the cosmetic industry. And he preached and practiced and believed in economics for our community. We should supply all the things that we use. And he was very critical of his people because they didn't live up to their God-given potentials and the God-given right to do business. And they didn't want to do business. And everything that's going on today is what Mr. Fuller had been waiting for, the wake-up call, because everybody wanted government legislation and integration, and it didn't become what they thought it would be. And a lot of people were disenfranchised with it. So a few people made it through the, matter of fact, you know, my father was one of the people that was actually became vice president of General Electric during the 1973. But this is rare, and the people that make it are professionals and you know, different people. But in business, he wanted us more involved in the economic welfare of our communities and doing business in our communities. And we consume everything, but we don't make anything. Oh. And he felt that we had an inferiority complex because you can't keep taking without giving and giving back. So he was very critical of what a lot of people did, but in the process he built, and his goal was to make 225 self-sufficient millionaires in America. One of these millionaires is, of course, George H. Johnson, George Johnson, Joe L. Dudley of Dudley Products Company. Mary Kay Ash was one of the people that sat in the meetings a lot of times to get good information. And he made comments, you know, on that, or having her in the meeting. But the whole thing of Mr. Fuller was self-sufficiency for everything. We had a God-given right to do business in our communities, but we just didn't. We didn't think it would be, you know, he even talked to Martin Luther King when he came to Chicago, and when they were doing the boycott on the bus company. He said, well, we'll just buy the bus company. And then you run it however you want to run it. That was his feeling. And he was the first African-American man of that era to buy a white company. He bought Boyer International Laboratories that had other cosmetic and a box company and other subsidiaries in that company for $150,000, this factory that was set in Chicago for many, many years. Wow. And he bought other businesses and helped other people get into business. He didn't care what you were selling as long as it didn't violate the laws of God and man. He would help you. I mean, Ebony started with, he never worked for Mr. Fuller officially, but the prescriptions were sold by door-to-door salespeople. There were 600 door-to-door salespeople and branches in every major city in Chicago. I mean, all over the country, every major city in the United States.
Unbelievable.
And he was doing his thing when everybody else was marching and protesting and speaking. He was on his job trying to create, you know, his business and keep his business going. He owned a major department store, and I mean a major department store. It was about three blocks long. The original Regal Theater in Chicago, of course, it's been torn down now. So has the Fuller Building been torn down. He owned two newspapers, the Pittsburgh Courier and the New York Age. And the reason that he bought that was so he could communicate with his people, because they had no way to communicate, and he could empower them through the newspaper. And he had sales meetings every morning at 7 o'clock to educate the people on their potential and what they needed to do. He taught you how to live life and how to enjoy it and how to get all the things that you want from life. So you could do better with your family. I mean, he took people off of welfare. He educated the people right in his offices and wow. his branches. And there were a lot of successful people came out of Fuller Products that aren't as well known, but still were millionaires in their own right.
So talk to me about this influence that Fuller had, that S.B. Fuller had at this time. It seems to be we have the same, and I'm saying collectively the African-American community, kind of the same consciousness that we had then we have now. There's a pocket. There's a pocket of great minds who, rather than march and protest, they develop economic power to make influence and change in the community, subsequently in the world. What do you see a parallel between then, the African-Americans of then and the African-Americans of now?
Well, I think they finally realized, well, we still got a long way to go. We're now learning about our culture. We're finally starting to wake up and realize some very significant things. And the thing is that marching doesn't work. It never worked. I mean, Mr. Fuller was totally against marching. He was totally against, you know, all the sit-ins and all that. Because if you don't like how somebody's running a business, go start your own and run it how you want to and service the people how they should be treated. We go into other people's stores demanding them to treat us right, but all we have to do is collectively. See, the thing we've never learned how to do, and Mr. Fuller was good at it, was raise money through his own wealth and influences through the community to create other businesses and get people involved in business. But we've never learned how to pull our money together as a collective and begin to build things for ourselves, hospitals for ourselves, grocery stores for ourselves. We're great at building churches. Mr. Bully said if we would spend as much time saving souls and start saving our money, we would be a lot farther ahead than we were. We have a long way to go, but the newer generation of the millennials are starting to realize that they have the potential to do what they want to do. So it'll still take some time for them to really realize what's going on. They need to know what Mr. Fuller was doing then and what he believed and his philosophy. And once we grab the hold of it, of self-sufficiency, you know, he used to talk about your God-given right. And he said, God never made a nobody. And everybody has a spark of divinity. And in that spark, you have to fan it for yourself. And that's believing in yourself and reaching the goals that you set for yourself and begin. Business is a luxury, but there's a lot of respect that goes with businesses. I've owned several businesses over the years. And once people realize you own this business, it's a totally different thing. I owned a car wash a couple of years back. And when people realized that I owned it, okay, it was a totally different attitude. The police were different. The customers were different. You know, people realized and gave you that kind of respect that, oh, you own this? Oh, they just think you're talking to just some Joe Schmo. But, you know, you get a certain
respect. The police treated you differently, and especially coming from Chicago. This is something that most of us never have a chance to talk to, if you will, and a business a black or should I say African American business insider on the psychology behind owning your own business. Because when you have economic power, there's a reason why law enforcement focuses only, particularly in Chicago and the African American community, in poor communities where they don't own businesses. And poor people.
Right.
Because when you own a business, that means you know lawyers. You can fight for a case. It makes it very difficult for them to try and do something to you because of the business and the money and all of the legal foundation that you have as a business owner. Really, can you speak to that, to the importance of that? Because that was a massive distinction there.
Well, I'll give you an example. At the car wash and at the beauty college, I was pulling in that day to the car wash, and the police had pulled someone over and were in my lot, you know, giving them a ticket. So I started walking over to the police officer to find out what was going on, and he's like, sir, you need to step away. You need to step away. I don't know who you are, blah, blah, blah. I said, well, you're on my property and I'm the owner of this business. Oh, okay, sir. Oh, well, she was pulled out, and then the explanation came, you know. I work closely with Joel Dudley and his wife, Eunice Dudley. And I do a lot of... I helped them with a beauty college. So, you know, of course I have keys to the beauty college, and I was sitting with my fiance in the car late night, talking in the parking lot, and a police officer pulled up. Well, he was in plain clothes, but I didn't see his badge. And he came up to me and asked me what I was doing. I said, well, what are you doing? You know, and two other, I assume, rookies got out of the car because they seemed kind of young. So he's like, well, what are you doing? And I'm saying, I'm sitting here talking with my friend. He's like, well, what are you doing here? I said, well, we just came out of my business, and your business. I said, yes, I own the building. I own the business here. Says twice he asked me, you own this? I said, well, do you want me to open it up and take you inside and show you what's, you know, what I do and what goes on here? He's like, no, that won't be necessary. Okay, I understand. And then he left me alone.
Fascinating.
That in itself just shut him down. You know, I mean, he was there to harass us. He was there to, you know, he got kind of smart with us. But once I told him I was the business owner, you're on my property, okay? It's a totally different attitude, totally different. This is in a black neighborhood, and the car wash was in a primarily white neighborhood. So, I mean, it's a totally different feeling. It's a totally different attitude that they give you. When you tell them you're the owner of this business, it's a totally different mindset for them, you know? And you get that that respect that you deserve.
Absolutely.
Not just because you're a business owner, but you should get the respect just, you know, police officers think everybody's a criminal, you know, especially in Chicago. So when you tell them, look, I own this, okay? And the other police officers like questioning, you really own this? You own this building? Well, who do you want me to call to tell you that I own this business. I'm part of this business here, and I own the building. I have keys to the building, you know. A lot of times I would walk through, because I do construction a lot. A lot of people thought that I was the janitor, you know, but really, you know, I had invested rights into this business. So I always keep a low profile on, you know, of course I'll suit up when I need to, when I have lectures or speeches, but I usually keep a low profile, because one thing I found out about wealthy people, they don't have to prove anything. Mm-hmm. You know, they generally, they buy a secondhand car of a reasonable year. They don't spend, they're not flashy. They're not, you know, wearing all that gold and silver and all that other stuff. Most millionaires, you wouldn't even know they're millionaires.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. If you saw them walking down the street. And that's another concept of wealth and knowing, you know, knowing that who you are and what you have to share in this life. And it doesn't take all that. I think our millennials are starting to realize, and they're starting to get it with economic development. But a lot of people don't understand economic development, because true economic development, and Mr. Fuller practiced true economic development, because he built a $5 million home in the poorest neighborhood, which was Robbins, Illinois. And he helped that community with his money and his influence to get a fire truck for the town. He put a water tower there. He purchased a water tower and worked with Chicago to bring water to that community, fresh water to the community.
Wow.
So that's true economic development. If you're going to preach economic development, you have to live in the communities that you're taking the wealth out of, because you have to leave it there. You can't take it. You're just like everybody else, because people that are primarily that are not of our race, and Mr. Fuller used to say this all the time, at the end of a business day, the significant businessman collects his money together and leaves our community and goes to his community to live. And there goes our wealth. So when our wealth leaves that community, it leaves our community impoverished. And that's the key to economic development. You have to live in the community that you're working with. You have to participate in all aspects of commerce and industry. Right now I'm in Gary, Indiana, working closely with the mayor, and I'm going to build a $5 million factory in Gary, Indiana, a Fuller manufacturing company in Gary. And I'm working with a lot of the community activists, quite a few of the churches, because I need the collective of the people to know me, get to know Mr. Fuller, and have the opportunity to understand the jobs and opportunities that I can provide for them.
Wow, that's absolutely amazing.
I need their support. You know, I need their support because they need to know that this is a black company. I don't want you to buy from me. And this is another thing. Everybody says, buy from me because I'm black. No. Buy from me because I produce a quality product at a competitive price, and I give and render a quality service. That's why I want you to do business with me. I don't want you to do business with me because I'm black. Because Mr. Fuller always, always stressed customer service and quality products, quality everything. He never skimped on quality. I mean, he had 600 people that would meet at the Palmer House Hotel. Now, how did he get into the Palmer House Hotel? Because he had the money. He had the wealth. Mm-hmm. He could afford. He had meetings with white. He had whites and blacks. Because when he bought Boyer International Laboratories, it was all a white company. And a lot of them were afraid that this black man's going to fire all of them. He didn't fire anyone. Because, you know, if you're good at what you do, you know, race has nothing to do with it. No one cares if the cow is black, brown, white. It's how much milk it can produce.
Mm. You know, I was watching an interaction between Steve Harvey and Monique on the Steve Harvey Show, and Steve Harvey said literally the exact same thing. Now, this is interesting because we're talking to a millionaire, and we're talking about a multimillionaire, S.B. Fuller, and this seems to be very consistent with African Americans who are in the multi-millions. And he said to Monique, he says, it's not about black, it's not about white, this is a money game. It's about the money game. You're saying something.
Well, it is.
You're saying something similar to that. Dig a little deeper for us to unpack that and what that means in terms of it's not about black and white, it's about it's not about the black or white, black or brown cow, it's about the milk.
Well, the thing is, that situation's a little bit different because Steve Harvey, he's not totally self-sufficient. When I talk about, and Mr. Fuller talked about self-sufficiency, meaning you don't have to depend on anybody for your wealth but yourself. I'll give you a perfect example. He was working in a coal yard, and he had three children at the time, plus a wife. And the gentleman came to check up on the coal, the business one day, and saw Mr. Fuller reading. And he asked him, what are you doing? He said, I'm reading a book. He said, what's the book about? On the art and science of selling. Okay, why are you reading that, SB? He said, because one day I want to become a salesman. He says, look, you're a black man. You have no formal education. I don't want you to get confused or, you know, I will, you know. He just basically told him, you know, if you stay with me, I'll have work for you for the rest of your life. And Mr. Puller turned around and told him, I quit your job today. Because if I stay with you and depend on you for the rest of my life to furnish me with work, I will never reach the goals that I have set for myself.
Wow.
Because he wanted to be rid of masterism. And that's people that are actors, people that are on TV, people that are in the limelight of TV viewing, they have limits on what they can do for the Black community. They have stipulations on them that they're not, I mean, yeah, it's nice when they donate. Yes, it's nice when they do certain things. Bill Cosby was a perfect example. He donated tons of money to colleges and young people. Many of the actors and many of the people do amazing things, and I'm not putting them down. But they can't do all the things that we really need done.
Wow.
And the thing is, the only time we're going to be able to do that is to have businesses of our own. Look, McDonald's just donated thousands and thousands of dollars to the medical, some medical organization. I heard a couple days ago that Home Depot donated like six. I'm trying to get this right. Don't quote me, but $600,000 to college funds to help people going to college. I mean, those are white businesses that are doing business, and that's where their revenue comes from. We depend on our actors, we depend on everybody but the people that we really need. And those are the business communities and the businesses in our communities. And we have to also learn how to support our community, you know, our businesses as well. We don't. We support everybody else. We help everybody else. We try to be part of everybody else, you know, but ourselves. And it's about self-sufficiency. It's totally about self-sufficiency.
Wow, this is absolutely incredible. So talk to me about this. How long, what happened to the Fuller business? There was a boycott, I believe, in 1960, somewhere around that time, in the 60s. What happened? What occurred? He didn't lose his business, did he?
No, he didn't lose the business. He lost a lot of what he had gained over the years, the theater, the department store, a couple of the newspapers. The thing was that he made a speech at the National Association of Manufacturers, 1963. And in 1963, I believe it was in New York City at one of the big hotels, but he gave a speech to the National Association of Manufacturers, which he was one of the first Blacks to participate in that. And his speech was actually misconstrued because they only published sections of his speech. And he said that we needed to have courage and we needed to, well, he said many things, but he explained the purpose of economics and the value of what we did, and we needed to pull our money together, and we needed to help be part of the wealth in America. And he said some critical things about African Americans, you know, that they really didn't like. And he wasn't with the normal party line of the literaries of the day. And he was more independent and saying, look, you don't need to march to Washington. You don't need to beg people. You're preaching helplessness. We need to stand on our own two feet. We have to have courage, integrity, and self-worth, and stop begging others for what we want or need in life. And they didn't take much kindly to that. And then it was actually Jackie Robinson that started a boycott. Of course, he never used Fuller products at the time, but it just started, a whole thing that people started boycotting Fuller products. Now, this was a business that employed thousands and thousands of African-American people.
Wow.
And it was like he didn't have a right to, everybody had a right to say what they wanted to say, but he didn't have the right to say that about black people. And like I said, Mr. Fuller was very critical of his people. And he didn't shy away from just telling you the way it was. And if you're ignorant, you're ignorant. Let's go on. Ooh. Oh, I'm not ignorant. I'm not this. I'm not that. Okay. Well, if you're not ignorant, why are you poor? Where do you live? He would ask you questions in the meeting to tell you about yourself, because you have to learn where you came from to know where you're going. If you don't know if you're in Chicago, how can you get to, Memphis, Tennessee? If you don't know where you're starting, okay? So his philosophy was very simple, but he was very critical because we just didn't, we believe in God, but we don't pray for wisdom. And that was his biggest key. He said one of his biggest things when he first came to Chicago was that he prayed to God. He said, God, if you give me the ability, the wisdom to get out of poverty, to become wealthy, I will spend the rest of my life teaching others. And that's what he basically did. And he fulfilled that all the way up till the day he passed away, because he was always in his office every morning, and he was always preaching, self-sufficiency, independence, self-reliance, and self-education. So he came here, he became a very dynamic speaker, and he had a speech impediment. He stammered. He didn't pronounce words well at all. And that was his desire, to become a great speaker. And he spoke every day about what you need to do and how to live life and how you can make it better in life for yourself. And he exposed African-American people to the luxuries of life. He gave away cars, Cadillacs.
Wow.
Before Oprah ever gave away a car. I mean, he did things like that. He gave away, prizes and different things, but he gave, in the Palmer House, he would have the car brought up in the elevator of the Palmer House Hotel and put on the floor where the meeting was or where the convention was, to give the award of a brand new Cadillac to a lot of his employees. So Mr. Fuller was the first. I mean, when he sold dresses in Memphis, he started a layaway program. He started a lot of things that we use today. But getting back to why they boycotted him, they boycotted him because he just wasn't, part of the movement of Martin Luther King was more preaching of government legislation to help us get our rights. Mr. Fuller Mr. Fuller said, we don't need civil rights. All we need is our civil. So, civil, who's civil? You know, this is a God-given right to every human being on this earth. You know, that this is my right to do this. And I've lived my life, I haven't really worked for anybody for years. I mean, I work for myself, I built businesses up, and I've done business for so many years, I wouldn't even know how to work for somebody. I've been an employer and never an employee. You know, in the early parts, yeah, you know, when you're young, you're starting off, you're working for people. But Mr. Fuller, when I came to work for Mr. Fuller, well, actually, I grew up in the branches. I would help stock the smaller shelves when I was young. I was 5 and 6 years old. And he would have me at the meetings. He would give me $5 to go up on the podium and tell the salesman to go to work. But that was back many, many years ago. But when I came, that was 1970s, when I came to work for Mr. Fuller, and I worked for him in the sales force, selling door to door, and it was the greatest experience I ever had in my life. I mean, the things that you learn going door to door, of course, people are saying, oh, you'll get robbed, you'll get this. You'll get robbed anyway. I never got robbed. I never got really bothered. But the thing is, it's how you carry yourself. It's how you project yourself when you're out there in the community, and how you look when you go out to the community. Most people won't even mess with you. Plus, when they find out you have cosmetics and they're going to have to sell them, they don't want it. They don't want the bag. But I went door to door, and it helped me. It helped me in my construction business. I landed a lot of jobs, you know, just by the training that you learn mm-hmm. in door to door selling.
Wow.
Selling our people is very difficult. And if we can get over that, we can do anything. I mean, selling is the primary goal of every business and industry. They bombard you with TV advertisements. You'll sit there for, I don't know how long. One day I counted all the commercials. There were like 10 commercials on TV. I mean, before you get to the show, you have so many commercials, you forget the show you were watching.
That's true.
Until they get back to it, you know? I'm like, but this is selling. They graduated from door to door. Every major company that is worth anything today, Sears, anybody, Walgreens, they started door to door. Everybody started door. Kraft started door to door. He went to the grocery store, it's Kraft. He went in and asked them what they sell his cheese. They told him, no, nobody knows you. We're not gonna sell your cheese. He went door to door, and some he gave away and most of what he sold. And he told them, ask for it in the store. Every customer he went to, he said, ask for it in the store. And when they couldn't get a hold of him, they would ask for it in the store. After a while, they came looking for crap because they wanted to put it in the store. I mean, great lesson. Where there's a will, there's always a way. You just have to have the will, and God will give you the way. And that was Mr. Fuller's philosophy. It was simple. It was nothing complex. I mean, he was doing seminars. They got people doing seminars now, life coaching and all this other stuff. And I'm not putting it down, but Mr. Fuller was doing life coaching long before that, you know, they even got the name. I mean, he did everything that he had to, he was single of purpose, and he dedicated his life to what he was doing. And that's what we have to do in our community. We have to dedicate our lives in our community to help our community and build up our community. And stop looking for handouts or government help, or that's like going to the master and saying, hey, master, give me a couple million dollars to put a business together. Yeah, okay. Yeah, it ain't happening. Mm-hmm. So you have to learn how to raise that money from your people by selling products and selling goods, and you have to pull the people together in our communities to know, we're a black company, we have a quality product, and we have excellent customer service. And let's do business. Because whatever Ultra Sheen or any other products that are out here are just as good as any other products anywhere else in the world. I mean, I'm going to be competing with body butters. People make body butters all the time, shampoos, lotions, creams, all this stuff. What's going to make mine better? That's my key. What's going to sell my product better than any other product? And that's the customer service and the pride of the product and the history of Fuller Products. A lot of people remember. A lot of people have passed away. older groups of people. But there was a lot of people out here that remember Fuller Product. Everybody looked good when they were when Fuller Products was around. Well, I hear from customers all the time.
Go ahead. You say you hear from customers all the time. Please continue.
Yeah. I mean, I have a lot of people that remember Fuller Products. And with me bringing it back, a lot of people say, oh, my mother had Fuller Products. I remember B-Sweet. That was an underarm wipe-on, underarm deodorant at the time. A lot of the young people remember, we're not young anymore, but they remember, and people will remember, and they'll learn about Fuller Products and its history and how great it was then and how great I'm going to make it again today.
Well, that's what I want to talk to you about. Talk to us about now bringing back the Fuller product, the Fuller brand. What does that look like? When can we expect it? How is it going to be rolled out? And why is this so important to you?
Well, my grandfather didn't leave me $2.3 trillion, but he left me a legacy of history. And if you're smart, you can build off of that. And this is a great story. This is something that'll go into the annals of history. I mean, it is in history. It is history. And because it's there, it needs, and the philosophy of Mr. Fuller needs to be taught today. We have an organization in Greensboro, North Carolina, the S.B. Fuller and Joel Dudley Foundation. And they're preparing to build a museum for business to show all black business people and showcase them at this museum. And also have training programs for entrepreneurs that want to become entrepreneurs. The Fuller philosophy of self-sufficiency, of independence, and God-given right, that's part of your privilege.
Mm-hmm. That is
your privilege.
That is the black privilege and yes. Black excellence.
Yes, yes.
Yep. Love that.
So
love
the importance of bringing it back is, I think, well, I know that we're more ready for it today than 1930s. Mm-hmm. And we actually had more businesses in 1930s and 40s and 50s than we did today. I mean, we lost a lot of things in integration. I mean, our grocery stores, our restaurants. Once we could integrate and go to their stores, a lot of people talk about it, white ice is better than black ice, So everybody went over to, the white side of town and spent their money. And that's what began the deterioration of our communities, because we're not spending money in our neighborhoods with ourselves anymore. We're not relying on people ourselves anymore doing business in our communities. Now, I'm not saying we don't have businesses, we just don't have enough for them.
Uh-huh.
And we need, and the cosmetic industry is a huge markup on products and manufacturing. And I don't expect to just stop there. In 2020, we'll be fully up manufacturing by 2020. And we'll have the full line of products. We have a natural line of products that we're developing now. I have a chemist that deals with all natural herbs and all natural, even almost food grade products. And he's developing how to make them last longer once they're packaged and bottled, so they have a better shelf life. But we're going to sell some of the old Fuller products as well, and those will be made out in North Carolina.
Fantastic. Well, you have our full support. A lot of people don't know or might not know if they haven't read my bio. I was a makeup artist years ago, went to cosmetology school, was the first beauty editor for Upscale magazine out of Atlanta. So I probably still do know cosmetics, beauty and fashion inside and out, but my life took a different direction. So I totally commend you, and you have my full support and the support of the Philippe Matthews Show. And I want you to come back and let's have a continuing conversation about the Fuller legacy, the Fuller philosophy, the Fuller mission, and all of the nuggets of wisdom that S.B. Fuller obviously passed on generationally to you, but how it can change the trajectory and the economics of us today, of all of us today.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. The purpose of me manufacturing is, my purpose is, I can show you better than I can tell you. So once I'm manufacturing up and going, then people will see, the jobs and the opportunities. I mean, the people that work in the factory, not everybody's going to get rich. It isn't ordained for everyone to become, rich. But you still have to live a life. You still have to work. You still have to, do your, live your life every day. Now, the thing about becoming rich or wealthy is a tremendous amount of dedication. I mean, it's a 24-hour, 7 days a week job. Uh-huh. I mean, there's, certain ways you have to conduct yourself, the attitudes, mindset, things you need to say and things you don't need to say. Endless amount of prayer every day, constantly, just to stay, you may be in this world, but you're not of this world. Right. So you have to distance yourself from some of the people that are just a little over the edge. But the thing is, you can make it. I've squandered fortunes and made money over the years, hand over fist. So I know what it is to be without, and I know what it feels like to have.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
But the world in our communities, we need to know what it means to have that feeling of confidence when you turn around and tell somebody of another race or another, this is my business.
Uh-huh.
This is mine. Uh-huh. Not to brag, not to show it off, uh-huh. but There's certain, my mother taught me something very important. And when I was growing up, of course, I rode motorcycles and looked like a greaser in the day when I was younger, better looking. But the thing is that I was at a woman's house and I was just, you know, seeing her daughter. And of course, she was white. And she was telling me, she was asking me, where did I live? And, you know, and asking me, you know, typical questions that a white mother would ask, you know, African-American young man that would show up at her house in a leather jacket and a motorcycle. So I never really liked telling people who my dad was or anything. But my mom said to me, very important, sometimes you need to tell people who you are. Sometimes you need to explain where you come from and your background. And at this particular day, she kind of put me down because she first thing she said is, do you live in Bridgeport? Well, I was brought up in Fairfield, Connecticut, which is one of the richest states in the union, okay? And I lived in a part of Fairfield where they didn't even allow Meadowlark Lemon. And he was a personal friend of the family, and his daughters were my friends, and his son. They didn't even let Meadowlark Lemon live in Greenfield Hill. Wow. Okay? But the thing was that she was saying, well, do you live in Bridgeport? Well, Bridgeport is the black, impoverished area. So I knew what she was saying. So I said, no. I live in Fairfield. What part of Fairfield? I live in Greenfield Hill. She stopped for a minute. Oh, yeah. My father is vice president of General Electric. That shut everything down. But she taught me this. It isn't that you're bragging, but it's sometimes you just need to tell people where you come from and what you're made of.
Put them in their place and shut them down.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And I've had to deal with that all my life, you know, my life. So I'm very observant of what people say. And we all have to be careful because words, and Mr. Fuller always used to say, when you hear someone speak, you always want to listen with a third ear because you have to judge what they're saying because in the words, what they're saying is their real agenda. Not the agenda that they're speaking of, but they always have alternative agendas. So you always have to listen very carefully. So, you know, when I was growing up in Fairfield, you know, the police would follow me home. I would ride my bike home. You know, I was going to high school at the time, and I was probably the only African-American. I was the only African-American in that community. So when they would follow me home, my father had to go down to the police station and tell them, well, there are black people living in Greenfield Hill. So you can stop sending your police following my son home every day, coming home from school. So I was kind of born with a little privilege and understand privilege. Uh-huh. You know, I understood my peers. They were blessed in a different way, but I was blessed in a more, you know, my father taught us that we had to, you know, if we wanted something, we had to work for it. We had to earn it. Okay. So it created a positive work ethic. And that's something we're missing today. Oh, a positive work ethic. We weren't handed things, you know, when I graduated high school, I didn't get a new Porsche. I was lucky that I got a bike. You know, my father was making $100,000 a year in 1973.
Wow.
$100,000 a year for a black man was pretty good. It was real good.
Like $1 million.
As president of, yeah. I mean, that was pretty good for that era. But a lot of things I learned with my father. He grew up in an era, he was a very serious man. And he grew up in an era where looking at a white woman, he could be lynched, hung, or harassed, you know, or killed. So that was a different lifestyle, a different, you know, a totally different world that, you know, that was, it was totally different. And of course, we'd sit around the table. We were kind of like the Cosby family, you know. My mother, a college graduate, and she was an accountant, and my father, of course, was a physician. Actually, my dad played professional football in Canada, the Canadian Blue Bombers, professionally, when he was doing his medical internship in Canada. So I come from good people, good stock, and I have a great history and a great determination. And I understand life, and I understand my purpose in it. And once you get to that point in your life, everything gets easy after that.
Fantastic. Martin Casey Fuller, thank you for this interview. Thank you for sharing this wisdom with me.
I feel blessed being on here because you've had a lot more famous people than me on here. People that I truly admire.
Well, I remember truly our first conversation about Dr. Joy DeGruy, and I appreciate that conversation, and I'm glad I was able to make that connection for between the two of you. You know, you just have to watch my show to know my dedication to the family and to the African-American community and what we need to know.
Oh, I have been. Yeah, I have been watching for quite some time. You're famous on your own.
I wouldn't say that.
You're famous on your own. You've done your due diligence. I've seen some of the people, that remarkable people that you've had on. And the reason I was following Joy DeGruy, Dr. Joy DeGruy, was because that is her book, and her concept and idea can be the turning point if all of us could experience what she talks about. Because
it was for me. It was for me. Yeah.
Me too. I mean, when I talk to her, you know, you never think they're the same people that you're going to talk to, but she was real. And I saw every video that she made, and she said, "Oh, I'm sorry if you had to do that." You know, but I listened to everything that she said, how she said it, and how she put it. She's funny, she's entertaining, and she's knowledgeable. I mean, she has it going on with the research that she did. And that's what we need, because we never recovered. Mr. Fuller said, we never recovered from slavery. We never got over slavery. And we don't know who we are. You know, we don't know where we come from. And it's been said a million times, if you don't know where you come from, you don't know where you're going.
Absolutely.
And Joy DeGruy, she brings it to light why we don't know and what we can do to fix it. You know, and that's what our people need. We need to understand why we are. Every African American in the world says at one time or another, what is wrong with our people?
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is what's wrong.
Right.
And she clarifies it all. She's just amazing with what she does. And I give her kudos on this, you know, discovering that and bringing it out in her book. It's just, it's amazing. It's amazing. And we need it. And I promote her every day.
Well, I'll be sending her this interview for
us. We were traumatized.
Yeah.
Yeah, she was on tour. I wanted her to be on a pod radio show that I sponsor right now. I wanted her, and I also was talking to her about coming out to Gary, Indiana. I'm going to work with quite a few pastors to somehow figure out how we can, you know, schedule her time to get out there, because the children are not well. That's what I told her. The children are not well. And it's about respect. You know, this is why we have so many churches, because that's the only way we're going to get respect. That's the key. Because look, you can tell somebody in a black community, oh, he's a businessman. They'll overlook it. Oh, he owns a business down the street. He owns this. Oh, okay, whatever. But tell him you're a pastor. Tell him you're a minister. Okay, pastor. That was the only respect we could get during slavery. Right. All that other stuff didn't mean anything. Wow. But if you are a pastor, you're a reverend, you got all the kudos. You got invited to people's homes for dinner. You got your respect. But how we have to find a different way to get respect, and that is in business and industry and in capitalism.
Fantastic. Thank you, my friend.
Thank you.
I appreciate you. We'll see you soon, and see you guys next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Stick around with me in the green room as we sign off, my good friend, and make sure you comment, make sure you like, tick on that bell so you can subscribe, so every time we do a show, you'll automatically get notified. We'll see you next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Hotep family.
Hotep.